Good morning, everyone. It was a continual witness to this. And yesterday I was just making the point that a large part of how to deal with the mind is how to reflect in the right way, to contemplate in the right way. And when you think about things in the right way, things tend to fall into place as a consequence. And this is very much part of the idea of right effort on the Buddhist path. So the right effort is really a lot to do with wisdom, how to think about the world, and so on. And this next sutta kind of expands on that theme, learning how to reflect wisely about things, and then through that process overcome some of the defilements of the mind. And this is one of the suttas, which is again an autobiographical sutta of the Buddha, where he talks about his own practice. He talks about how he overcomes the defilements in his own mind, basically, and then takes it to awakening as a consequence of that, overcoming of those defilements. And that already is quite nice. I mentioned this before, is this idea that the Buddha himself, he had very similar problems to the problems that we have. He had to overcome defilements. Here he talks specifically about three kinds of defilements: sensual desire, ill will, and the last one is like harmfulness, if you like, to be harmful towards living beings. So it, very similar to what anyone else we all encounter really on the Buddhist path, which is kind of encouraging. Even the Buddha had to go through these things. So this sutta is from the Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length sayings of the Buddha, two kinds of thought, the Dvaita Vitakka Sutta, Majjhima Nikaya number 19, it's the next one following on from yesterday. And this is how it goes. Thus have I heard on one occasion the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jeta's Grove, another Pindaka's park. There he addressed the bhikkhus thus, "Bhikkhus, Venerable Sir," they replied, and the Blessed One said this, "Bhikkhus, before my awakening, while I was still an unawakened bodhisattva, it occurred to me, suppose that I divide my thoughts into two classes. Then I set on one side thoughts of sensual desire, thoughts of ill will, and thoughts of cruelty. And I set on the other side thoughts of renunciation, thoughts of non-ill will, and thoughts of non-cruelty. As I abided thus, diligent, ardent, and resolute." I can stop there in the middle of that sentence, because that's kind of it's a suitable place to stop. So just to have a quick look at this, and just one way of background, of course, Savati is one of the monasteries where the Buddha spent the most time. After his awakening, he said he has spent 20 writing retreats there. I don't know how reliable that information is, but that's what it said. And if you travel to India in the present day, you can go to Savati in the present day, go to the Jeta Grove and see all of these things. And that, how many of you have been to India on the kind of Buddhist pilgrimage? Yes? Yeah, a few of you have? Okay, yeah. Great. And it's one of those wonderful things, is actually to go to India and see some of these places. It's not almost as if you are stepping back in time, and you can recognize things. And you recognize the features, you know, these places are often described in the suttas, the geographical features and all these kind of things. And you go to India and you see it's exactly the way it's described in the suttas. So it kind of makes the suttas real in a way which otherwise, you know, you're not really sure are they just stories or are they real or whatever. It can be hard to really tell. But when you go there, it feels almost like you're stepping into the ancient India. There is a sutra about that later on. I'll talk about that later on when I get to it, because that's a very classic example of how things are the same in India, 2,500 years ago compared to now. It's pretty much the same. Nothing has really changed in India. India is kind of this eternal, well, it's not eternal quite, but this kind of things are often very stable, that nothing much changes even over 2,500 years. It's very interesting. And Savati is one of those beautiful places to go to. It's quite one of the more peaceful places in India. One of the problems with going on pilgrimage in India is that it is often so noisy. Yeah, you go to Bodh Gaya, it's supposed to be an inspiring place, but actually Bodh Gaya is this incredibly noisy place. So sometimes you have to choose your sites of pilgrimage with a bit of care to go to those places that are peaceful and nice and etc. Otherwise, it is you wonder whether it's really worth it sometimes. So, but there are some places that are still a bit out of the way. Rajagaha is very beautiful. It's very peaceful. You go up on the Vulture Peak. Yeah, it's also a place found in the suttas. And it can be very inspiring when you go to these places. You get a feeling, you sit there, you get this feeling for being kind of in the presence of the Buddha in a different way from when you are far, geographically far removed. So I think at least once in a lifetime, it's a nice thing to do. Of course, Ajahn Brahm says the real holy sites are the holy sites within. And of course, that's true. Yeah, the real holy sites are the, Ajahn Brahm says, first, second, third, and fourth jhana. That's the real holy places. I think it's a good point he's making. But sometimes these other things can be a kind of a help on the way here. So that's samadhi. Jetas growth after Pindaka's park. And then the Buddha says, before my awakening, while I was still an awakened bodhisattva. So what is this one about? How come the Buddha is talking about himself as a bodhisattva? What does that mean? And does that mean that the idea of a bodhisattva that kind of arose after the Buddha, that there actually is a basis for that in the suttas? Is that what it means? And this is why you have to be very careful, because it's easy to misunderstand what is going on here. In the suttas, the word bodhisattva has only one meaning, and the meaning is, actually not, that's not quite right, but it almost has only one meaning, and that is the Buddha to be, after he goes forth from the home life, to search for a problem to existence, search for a solution to the problems of existence, at that time he's called bodhisattva. So it's only after he goes forward that then he's kind of searching for a solution to the problem of suffering, trying to find happiness in the life. That is what he's called the bodhisattva in the suttas. There is a couple of exceptions to that. There is the Acharya Bhutta Sutta, which is found in the Majjhima Nikaya 123, which means something like wonderful and marvelous. And it's all about the wonders that happen, especially around the Buddha's birth and these sort of things. But that sutta has a lot of, is not all that reliable. It's very, quite different in the different traditions and all these things. So I wouldn't take it, I don't take that sutta as seriously as I take many of the other ones. But essentially, bodhisattva, and this is the important point, is only after the Buddha goes forth in his last life, then he is a bodhisattva. Why is he a bodhisattva at this point? What is this all about? This is an interesting point about the meaning of Pali words. Bodhisattva, with a V in it, this is the Sanskrit version of the Pali word bodhisattva. Bodhisattva means like awakening being. Sattva is a being or a creature, and bodhi is awakening. What that means, awakening being. Kind of strange, isn't it? Awakening being. Obviously means something like a being who is, who is on the path to awakening. So it's not really clear exactly what it means. What is interesting about this word is that it can have different meanings depending on how you read the original. And it could have meant, and this was made by a scholar a few years ago at this point, that actually the Sanskrit word behind bodhisattva could be bodhisakta. And bodhisakta means like intent on, searching for, It means someone who is trying to achieve something. So what it probably means, and this is how Bhatta Sujata translates this word now, he translates it as, and I think it is correct, that you are the one who is searching for awakening, you are intent on awakening. And that's exactly what the Buddha is. After he leaves the home life, he's intent on awakening. That's the whole point. So it kind of fits in with the overall kind of story, and the overall development in the Buddha to be his life. It fits really well. So the Buddha is the one who is intent on awakening before his awakening. So how to read this then? It becomes something like Bhikkhus, before my awakening, while I was still unawakened and intent on awakening. That's really what it kind of comes down to. So That, of course, later on, this idea of bodhisattva becomes very much more developed, and not only in the Mahayana Buddhism, but in Theravada Buddhism as well. You get all the commentaries that talk about the Buddha's kind of long search in the past lives, all these kind of things. And as I mentioned before, even in the present day, you find monastics who call themselves bodhisattvas, also within the Theravada tradition. You ask them, and they say, yeah, I'm a bodhisattva. And the very famous monk in Sri Lanka called Ananda Maitreya, he was one of these monks who considered himself a bodhisattva, I understand that. He was a teacher of Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi, by the way. Anyway, so then it occurred to the Buddha to be the bodhisattva, or bodhisatta, I should say. Suppose I divide my thoughts into two classes. And then on the one side we have the thoughts that are thoughts that are kind of problematic, sensual desire, ill will, and cruelty here. And on the other side, the thoughts that are non-problematic, renunciation, non-ill will, and non-cruelty. And then in the next line it says, as I abided thus, diligent, ardent, and resolute. So that's kind of fascinating, because what that means, and this kind of shows you the point I was making before about reflection and wisdom being so important on the path. What the Buddha here calls, the Buddha calls diligent, ardent, and resolute, is the fact of dividing your thoughts into two classes. That's how you are diligent, ardent, and resolute. Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? It's not about being working hard or trying hard or anything like that. It's the very fact that you have the wisdom and the ability to divide your world into the wholesome and the unwholesome. That is what is diligent, ardent, and resolute. It shows you again that the whole, this is about wisdom. It's about insight, about reflection, about contemplating things in the right way. That is what diligence, one of the important meanings of diligence. Actually, I'll come back to this in a second. Diligent, I don't think is quite the right translation here. But I'll get back to that in a second, once we get through the other parts here. So you divide your thoughts into two classes. The unwholesome ones on one side, and the wholesome ones on the other side. That may seem simple, but remember, this is not as easy as it may seem. Now, first of all, we have to actually understand that certain thoughts are unwholesome or problematic, or they lead to dangerous things. And the majority of people don't understand, for example, that sensual pleasures can be problematic. They would think of it as just fun. Yeah, you're having a good time, you're enjoying yourself. Why is that problematic? So even that takes a degree of insight to understand the downside of some of these thoughts. This is the first part of it. The other part is, to really divide these things into two classes means that you have to see them in a very deep way, because these things come in a broad range of, broad variety of qualities, from very refined aspects, of these. It's not very good, is it? Be quiet. Okay, so very refined aspects of sensuality and ill will to very coarse aspects, and to understand the whole range actually takes insight. Everyone knows what the coarse aspects of these things are, but the very refined ones, hardly anyone knows what they are. Once you get into, your mind starts to become very peaceful, and you can't go any further. And you don't know why you can't go any further. There's something blocking you from taking you into real samadhi, into a state of tremendous calm and bliss and all these things, but you can't see it. And the reason you can't see it is because the defilement is so refined that you have never really encountered it before. There's something you're holding on to, there's something you're attached to, but you're not even aware of it. And this is why the uncovering of the mind, uncovering, understanding the problems of the mind, is a process that takes time. This is why Satipatthana practice, a very important part of Satipatthana, is to understand the five hindrances, what causes them, what they are, all of these aspects. Because we don't normally know that. And this is what kind of makes the Buddha special here. He doesn't even have a teacher, and yet he has this ability to reflect and contemplate on the mind in this way, to bring out, to understand these things in its fullest consequences and its fullest kind of depth. So you put two classes. On the one side, you have the thoughts of sensual desire, Yeah, and remember, this can go very deeply. Any attachment to the senses, yeah, is actually included in this. So if you are not willing to let the sense of sight just disappear and be gone, there is some sensual desire there, some attachment to the senses. So it goes very, very deeply, and you can start to see why this is problematic and why it can block out your ability to go deeper here. So that's just one of them. Ill will, we know what that is. Ill will is being, having negative thoughts about others, being angry with them, being irritated by them, all of that. It's fairly obvious. The last one is thoughts of cruelty, it says here. And cruelty is not a very good translation of this last word. Vihinsa, Bhikkhu translates it more recently as harming, thoughts of harming, which is better. But what it really means, it means a lack of care for what happens to other people. It means like being ruthless in a sense, yeah, inconsiderate, not caring what you if what you how you live your life kind of affects other people badly, you kind of shrug your shoulders, this is their problem. So it's different from ill will, because you don't actually have ill will, it's just that you don't care what happens to others. You are ruthless in a sense, yeah? Your job is to get your business going, and whether other people suffer through your business, you fire people right and center, all these kind of things. You don't really care about that. So ruthless is a good one. And the opposite of being ruthless, what is that? It is to be compassionate. Yeah? Apparently there is a word called ruthful. Have you ever heard of the word ruthful before? Yeah. It's kind of a nice word, ruthful. Because ruth is compassion. Yeah, so ruthful is compassion. But it's the opposite of vihinsa is compassion, basically. The opposite of ill will is metta. Yeah, ill will is focusing on the bad qualities in a person. Metta is seeing the good qualities. Ruthlessness is not caring about the consequences for others. Having compassion is caring about whether other people suffer or not. And the last one is the idea of renunciation. When we talk about renunciation on the Buddhist path, the main meaning of that is renouncing the attachment to sensual pleasures. Yeah? That's what renunciation really means. It's the sensuality which is the focus here now. So you divide the world up into these two things, these two categories, unwholesome qualities and wholesome qualities on the other hand. And that is what it means to be, it says here, diligent. Ardent and resolute. Diligent is an appamado. Yeah, appamado is this very well-known word in the Pali Sutras. We find it in so many different places. And diligent doesn't really quite capture it, because diligent in English means like you are working hard, you're being diligent, not messing around, yeah, getting on with it, applying yourself all the time. That's really what it means. But this is what appamado means in Pali. What it means is that you are careful. Yeah, you are circumspect. You are heedful. Heedful is a translation used by Bhikkhu now, and it's a far better translation. In other words, you're circumspect. It doesn't mean that you're always applying yourself and working very hard. But you kind of think about things before you do it. You reflect about things. That is the idea of being appamada. What should I do to live better and to enhance the quality of my own life and the life of people around me? Ardent is a very kind of unusual word. It's not something people normally use. The Pali is atapi, and it basically means something like using effort or energy. Yeah, that is one of the main aspects of ardent. The word ardent is one of the things about the one about things about some of these words that they are often used in quite a specific context. So for example, the sixth factor of the Noble Eightfold Path, you have Sammapadana or Sammavayamana. Yeah, and it means how to exert yourself, how to make the right effort. But then you also have the idea of virya in Buddhism. Virya means energy. Yeah. So what is the difference between these things? And the difference is that when you exert yourself using padana and vayama, you are trying to achieve something. You're using a little bit of willpower and volition, a little bit of doing to make things work. Yeah? Virya in Buddhism is the natural energy of the mind. So when you develop your mindfulness well, you start to get a bright mind, you start to feel happy, there's energy with that. It's a natural energy of the mind. You don't have to apply yourself anymore because that energy is there. Yeah, there's a difference there between forcing the energy and just handing it naturally. And Atapi is almost like a halfway house between the two. You see it in the Satipatthana Sutta, it is almost like the transition from exerting the self to having the natural energy of the mind. So this is what we're seeing here. There's a degree of exertion here. And then the last one is pahitatta, is the idea of resolute, and that is related to the word padana, which means effort, making a degree. So you're making some degree of effort here, yeah? You are diligent, making an effort, using energy here. And that is what it refers back to, this idea of dividing your thoughts into two classes. That's how you are diligent on the Buddhist path. That's how you're heedful. That's how you apply yourself. So, is the sound okay? I'm a bit worried about the sound. Is it a bit good? Yeah, no. Okay, no. Okay, good. It gets a bit metallic sometimes, but we'll see what happens. So as you abide in this way, you have made this distinction between the good thoughts and the bad thoughts. While you do that, the thought of sensual desire arose in me. Yeah, and then the Buddha to be, he thinks, I understood thus. This thought of sensual desire has arisen in me. Yeah, this is the first point to actually understand that what is a thought of sensual desire. And again, the coarse ones are obvious. We know exactly what that is. It's the refined ones that are harder to understand. So we need to kind of really pinpoint it to be very clear about what these things mean. And this is, again, the job of part of meditation practice, what it is about. And then he thinks, and this is kind of the interesting part here, he thinks, this leads to my own affliction, yeah, my own suffering, to others' affliction, to the affliction of both. It obstructs wisdom, causes difficulties, and leads away from Nibbana. When I considered all of these things, this leads to my own affliction, it subsided in me. When I considered this leads to the affliction of others, it subsided in me. When I considered it leads to the affliction of both, it subsided in me. When I considered this obstructs wisdom, causes difficulties, and leads away from Nibbana, it subsided in me. Yeah? Whenever a thought of sensual desire arose in me, I abandoned it, removed it, did away with it. So, this is how you abandon bad thoughts. Yeah, this is how you abandon it, remove it, do away with it. These words are quite strong. It sounds like you're using effort. If you were to read that just like that, it sounds like you're removing your effort to do away with it or to make an end of it, which is the literal, more literal Pali translation of the Pali. You remove it. It often sounds like there's a degree of effort on there. But actually, if you notice how the Buddha does this, it is not so much willpower that he uses here. It is all about reflecting in the right way. It's all about using wisdom. Yeah, all of these things, there's understanding the problematic nature of these thoughts. And when you understand the problematic nature, they disappear on their own. Of course, there is a degree of effort there because the very fact of reflecting, of thinking about things in the right way, the very fact of using wisdom, it implies a degree of effort. But it's not the kind of usual effort that we use, where we kind of just suppress things or force things, that sort of thing. It's a much more subtle kind of effort. The effort to direct your mind in the right direction, to think about things in the right way. And these things, they may sound, I don't know, maybe they sound difficult to you, but actually not all that hard. They are only difficult because you haven't really applied yourself in this way before. Once you start to think about these things in the right way, you start to reflect on this, it's actually quite easy. Yeah, this is kind of the point with this. It's just that you're not used to it, and that's why it may seem foreign or alien or a bit difficult. So what does it actually mean? So what it means is that the Buddha considers, this leads to my own affliction. Yeah, and of course, if something leads to your own suffering or difficulties or pain or whatever, if you really get that it is problematic, you won't do it. Yeah, the mind won't go there because you know it's problematic. Of course, when it comes to sensual pleasures, it is quite can be hard to see that because we're used to thinking of the sensuality of the world as something positive, something helpful. Something nice, yeah, kind of the playground of the world, so to speak. So to be able to do this, you have to actually think carefully of what is going on here. And the sort of things that you have to think about is one of the things that you know when you get into sensual pleasures, that you always attach to things. If you're attached to things, you're asking for suffering, because down the line, these things will have to be let go of again. That is one enormous problem with sensuality. Another one is that it always is conjoined with craving. Craving is a state which is inherently unpleasant. If you look at it in the right way, it is unpleasant, because you feel agitated, you feel restless, you don't feel satisfied, you don't feel complete. You feel as if there is this itch that needs to be itched constantly, and it always keeps on going. You never get rid of that itch. Yeah, this is another problem with sensuality. Another one is that it always tends to lead to conflict with other people. Sensuality is really the source of conflict. There's so much conflict in the world, so much ill will, so many problems. Why? Because we desire the same sensual objects in the world. Wars are fought over resources, over things that ultimately, you know, are about sensuality. Sensuality, in the final analysis, if you like, the biggest problem with sensuality is that it is the main bond that binds us to samsaric existence, that drives on this round of birth and death, going on from life to life, potentially indefinitely into the future. So there is lots of problems with sensuality. It's just that we haven't really got clarity about that. All of those things that I mentioned, that I'm sure you can relate to that to some extent, but the question is, how deeply do you relate to it? And the more deeply you relate to it, the more easy it is to understand that actually that is not a place to go. It is a place to be avoided. And when you understand it very deeply, your mind just doesn't go there anymore. And the way, one of the symbols I like to use to explain how this works is that it's a bit like, you know, you're wandering around your apartment or your house or something like that, and somebody has turned on the hot plate there. You're not aware that the hot plate is on. Yeah, you don't know, so you kind of wander around and you kind of put your hand to rest on the hot plate because you think it's cold, but actually it's really hot. And then when you put your hand on the hot plate, you don't have to think, should I remove it or not? Yeah, should I remove it or not? I wonder. You don't, just bam, you go straight away because you know this is going to burn you. Yeah, so it is an automatic reaction that you withdraw your hand because it just happens just like that. And it's exactly the same way when you understand, fully understand that something is suffering, the mind doesn't go there. You don't have to reflect too much about it. The mind just withdraws. It recoils from that thing because you know that it's problematic and it's suffering. And this is what happens to the minds of those people who are Aryans, noble ones, because they have a full insight into the problems of sensuality, all the problems in the world, because they understand what these things are. Their minds just don't go there. They recoil from these things. Okay, as a stream enterer or whatever, you still have some sensuality left, but essentially you understand what they are about. And once you apply your mind in the right way, the mind withdraws from these things. So this is kind of the test, yeah, for how deeply you have understood whether these things are suffering or not. Does your mind go there to play around with these things? Or does it kind of recoil from that because you understand the dangers? So this is what you have to keep on, keep at. And this is where the reflection comes in, yeah? How do you think about these things in such a way that your mind actually withdraws from these things? And some of the things I just mentioned before, these are the kind of reflections you want to use. And of course, not only is it bad for yourself, it always starts off with oneself always, which is kind of nice about Buddhism, yeah? We look after ourselves first. Kind of nice, it's very different from how we used to think about things. That's kind of the Buddhist idea. Look after yourself first. Why? Well, because you are closest to yourself, because you can help yourself more than you can help others. It kind of makes sense to start with yourself. And then, if you're able to deal with yourself, well, then you become an example for others. And then your teachings have much more impact anyway. So it kind of makes very good sense to start with oneself for so many reasons. But then it also leads to the affliction of others. Yeah, because we get into conflict with other people and all of these kind of things. So other people too are affected by the fact that we are attached to sensual pleasures and we crave for sensual pleasures and these kind of things. And it leads to the affliction of both. Yeah, sometimes you may think, oh yeah, I can sacrifice myself for others, but it doesn't work like that. Actually, both parties are affected by these things. Both parties suffer as a consequence of one of them pursuing sensual pleasures in the world. So there you are. That's good enough reason already, right? To abandon these things a little bit and move to the happiness inside. The beautiful thing about the happiness inside, the happiness of meditation, is that it does not have lead to conflict with other people because it is independent of other people. And then we have the other thought that the Buddha has here. It obstructs wisdom. Yeah, panya, nirodhika. It leads to the cessation of wisdom, this particular sensual desires. Why is that? It's because when you have sensual desires, you have a vested interest in that object. You're no longer able to be impartial. You're no longer able to see things according to reality because you are already biased at that particular point. As soon as sensual desire has arisen, you are deluded, basically. That's what it's saying here. Because you are biased by that desire here. So, panya nirodhika leads to the cessation of wisdom. That's kind of concerning, isn't it? Because wisdom is, I don't know about you, but I find the idea of wisdom very attractive. If there's anything I'd like to be in the world, is wise. Yeah, because wisdom, there's something very beautiful about being wise. It means that you know what is the right thing to do to lead to more happiness in the world, that leads away from suffering. What is appropriate at any particular time to do to help others and to do the right thing. Wisdom is kind of something very beautiful about that. And if something leads to the cessation of wisdom, it's a major concern. Yeah, it's a really a big problem. And just to reflect on that again is very useful. It causes difficulties, well, we have seen that already in the sensor, and it leads away from Nibbana. And this last one, leads away from Nibbana, I have always felt that Nibbana should be translated. One of the things that I did with Bhapa Sujata, we were talking about the translation of the suttas, because he was translating the Vinaya. One of the things that we agreed on very early on was that everything should be translated. Because if you don't translate things, you're just leading it to people's imagination, what these things actually mean. So the word Nibbana to us means nothing. Yeah, you hear the word Nibbana, it might mean something because we have kind of taken the word into our culture. Yeah, so it means like a band, an Australian band called Nirvana, something like that, back in the 1980s. But, you know, it means things, but very often it's very misleading because it becomes part of pop culture and all these kind of things. And for this reason, actually, it is very useful to translate these words. The word like Nibbana would have had a very specific meaning to the people of ancient India because they were part of the ordinary vocabulary. Yeah, these were actually words with a certain meaning. To us, it means nothing. We can put anything we like into it. But for them, it had a meaning. So what was that meaning here? Well, that meaning was something like extinguishment. Yeah, a fire being extinguished, or the eternal fires inside of us being extinguished. That is really what Nibbana is. So appropriate translation of Nibbana is something like extinguishment. Some people say extinction, but extinction has a very negative kind of feeling about it. So I prefer extinguishment. You extinguish the fires of greed, hatred, and delusion. Yeah? What does that mean? It means you become calm, you become peaceful, you become happy. That's really what it means. So the way to understand Nibbana is to basically just look inside of yourself and start to see that gradual extinguishment happening in meditation practice. As the defilements are gradually disappearing, the mind is becoming peaceful, you are becoming extinguished. And it's pretty marvelous to become extinguished. Yeah, it's actually very nice to become extinguished. So when you think about it that way, then this extinguishment becomes a very beautiful quality. And that stops us from reading all kind of nonsense into Nibbana, which actually is not there. So very, I think it's very useful to translate. Virtually every word in the Pali Canon is good to translate. Place names, obviously not, but apart from that, I think it's very useful. So it leads away from Nibbana, it leads away from calm, from peace, from being cool inside. It leads to more defilements and more problems. That's really what it means in this particular case. So you will, of course, the point here, of course, is also that this is the Buddha to be who is talking here, so he doesn't really know exactly what Nibbana is yet. Yeah, so he's using nirvana in a very broad sense here, as meaning something peaceful and calm and positive. And then, of course, based on that, all of these things subside. All of this defilement actually disappears because of that. And this is how you abandon it, how you remove them, how you do away with the defilements. And I think this is such an important point, because normally it is so easy to use willpower. We do that all the time. You know, in daily life, for example, you have a thought arise in your mind, you get ill will against somebody, and you think, no, this is not appropriate. So you kind of suppress it, you hold it back. This is kind of our default reaction when we have emotions that we know are not really right at that time. So we just suppress them. And the problem with suppression in this way is twofold. First of all, So the problem with suppressing things is that, first of all, it takes a lot of energy. It drains your energy if you keep on suppressing things or holding them down. After a while, you feel tired. And when you feel tired, very often what happens, as soon as you then let go of that suppression, you let go of holding things down, it comes back again. And often when it comes back with like a vengeance, with even more power than before. So the problem with suppression is that it's not really sustainable. It doesn't really get rid of the thought. It just kind of keeps it under the surface. It kind of holds it down, and it springs back again with even more powerfully later on. But if you use the wisdom power, if you use the ability to think about things in the right way, you don't suppress the thought. What you do is you eliminate it. If you understand that sensual desire or ill will is really bad, and you turn your mind away from that, it is actually gone. Yeah, it is completely gone. And because it is gone, first of all, you haven't expended a lot of energy on suppression. So your energy is retained, you can continue your practice. And secondly, the defilement actually disappears. So if you want to remove things, if you want to do away with things, if you want to eliminate them, the only way to do that is actually by using wisdom, not by using willpower. This is kind of the message here. And it's a very important point, because as I mentioned before, we often use, in English language, we use words like restraint. Other places there are words used like annihilate these thoughts, or abolish them, obliterate them, is one translation that is used. These are very strong words. Obliterate is like, you smash it to pieces. Yeah, it sounds like an enormous amount of willpower. But actually, the only way to obliterate these thoughts is by using wisdom, because only then are they actually abandoned properly. You cannot obliterate by using willpower. It's the wisdom power that obliterates these thoughts. That's a very important point of Dhamma, an important point of understanding how the path works. Wisdom power is far more powerful in eliminating negative qualities of mind than using just mere suppression and willpower. So this is what is going on here. Then we have the same thing for the other kinds of thought. As I abided thus, heedful, energetic, and with effort, a thought of ill will arose in me. A thought of ruthlessness, or being ruthless arose in me. I understood this thought of being ruthless has arisen in me. This leads to my own affliction, to others' affliction, to the affliction of both. It obstructs wisdom, causes difficulties, leads away from nibbana. When I consider thus, it subsided in me. Whenever a thought of being harmful or ruthless arose in me, I abandoned it, removed it, did away with it. So here we have the two other kinds of thought. Thoughts of ill will. With these thoughts, it is much easier to understand why they are problematic. Ill will leads to enormous problems in life. It leads to destruction of relationships. It leads to, ultimately to wars and all kinds of massive problems. So it is fairly obvious why that is a problem, but still, it is really worthwhile reflecting on it, because very often ill will also can be attractive to us. Yeah, if you feel something is wrong in the world, something isn't quite right, you feel, you know, self-righteous anger and this kind of things. Yeah, I have the right to be angry. Anger is good in this particular case because, you know, it gives me the energy to sort things out, all these kind of things. And that is, so it's often it's useful to remember the downside. The downside, again, is that you end up doing things which are very destructive, and you are distorted in your outlook. When you're angry, you don't know really what is right and what is wrong anymore. Your outlook is distorted and you have a biased view of things. So you're not able to actually do what is in the best interest of yourself or others anymore. So everything kind of falls down once these defilements arise from you. Yeah. Same thing with being ruthless, yeah, or harmful. Same kind of idea. It leads to lots of problems in the world. So in these cases, it's easier to understand. So I'm going to have more of a look at this later on, but this is just like an introduction to how to deal with these thoughts. So. I'm going to skip one paragraph and come back to that one in a second. We get to the next one. This is a nice little simile here. The sutta is always full of beautiful little similes. The Buddha says, just as in the last month of the rainy season, in the autumn, when the crops thicken, a cowherd would guard his cows by constantly tapping and poking them on this side and that side with a stick to check and curb them. Why is that? Because he sees that he could be flogged, imprisoned, fined, or blamed if he let them stray into the crops. So too I saw in unwholesome states danger, degradation, and defilement, and in wholesome states the blessing of renunciation, the aspect of cleansing. So the cowherd, yeah, he kind of worried about the cows kind of wandering into the crops, eating all the crops of the farmer. Makes you very unpopular with the farmer if that happens. And then you get flogged and imprisoned and blamed if that happens. So of course the point here is that you're tapping and poking your mind a little bit, making sure it doesn't stray into unwholesome thoughts. Because if you do that, you get flogged. In other words, that's the suffering that is consequent upon thinking thoughts that are unwholesome and problematic. Yeah, so you tap your cow mind a little bit. So you go this way, go that way. And then the cow mind says, okay, yes sir, yes ma'am, I'll do what you're saying. That's kind of the idea here. So in the same way, you saw the danger in unwholesome states. Yeah, we have seen this already, the danger in them, the problem, how they lead to suffering, the degradation. Okara literally means to make low, yeah, to degrade something means to kind of bring it down, make it lower. And it's interesting, it's one of those things, if you think about what you feel like inside when you have kind of defiled thoughts compared to when your mind is quite pure. One of them feels more noble, right? One of them feels more, you feel kind of, you know this is a more noble way of existing, and the other one feels kind of lower. Yeah, and this, of course, is the real kind of nobility on the path. The nobility is the nobility of character. That is the real nobility in the world. Not nobility by birth, but nobility by character. And anyone has the ability to be noble by character. If you see how the suttas define what is considered a high birth and a low birth, it always has to do with nobility of character. If you're born as a Brahmin, it's kind of irrelevant. You become a Brahmin through your development, through how you live your life. That's how you become a Brahmin. It's kind of very nice and egalitarian, isn't it? It's actually how we live that really matters in life. All this other stuff is just superficial and it's kind of irrelevant. So don't degrade yourself. Don't push yourself down by thinking too many bad thoughts. Make yourself noble inside. Develop a noble mindset, and then you become noble in character. Yeah. It's a nice way of thinking about things. Yeah. States of degradation, defilement. Yeah, your mind is defiled. It is like dirty. It is not pure. And that dirty mind just doesn't feel good in the same way. Yeah. Unwholesome state of blessing or renunciation, the aspect of cleansing, which is the opposite of defilement. Cleaning out, purifying the mind. And these words don't sound perhaps all that inspiring in their own right. Clean mind, purified mind. So the only way to really understand what these things refer to is to feel them. Yeah? What does it feel when your mind is purer? What does it feel when the defilements aren't there? What does it feel when you have compassion and loving kindness? What does it feel when you are generous? What does it feel to be mean and nasty? Yeah, and you know what it feels like. One feels good, the other one feels narrow, confined, and negative. That's what it meant by the problem of defilement versus the problem of purity. So instead of thinking of this as, think of them as lived experiences, and then you know why one of them is far preferable to the other one. There's a beautiful little simile there by the Buddha, the idea of the cows. So you have to tap and poke your mind a little bit, which means reflect in the right way. That's really what it means. And as you do that, the mind doesn't go astray into the crops or whatever. Then I'll go back to the previous paragraph. The reason why I have turned this to around is because I think it is quite possible that the sequence originally was the opposite, that the simile came first, because that is what it is in the Chinese version of the sutta. In the Chinese version, the simile comes first, and this other paragraph comes afterwards. So that's why I turned them around. So the Buddha says, bhikkhus, whatever a bhikkhu frequently thinks and ponders upon, that would become the inclination of his mind. If he frequently thinks and ponders upon thoughts of sensual desire, he has abandoned the thought of renunciation to cultivate the thought of sensual desire. And then his mind inclines to thoughts of sensual desire. If he frequently thinks and ponders upon thoughts of ill will, upon thoughts of harming, he has abandoned the thought of non-harming to cultivate the thought of harming. And then his mind inclines to the thought of harming. And this is one of those beautiful little things again, is that it shows you how the mind is gradually conditioned. You learn slowly to think about things in a new way, in a different way. And as you do that, it gradually becomes easier. The initial part is always the hardest one. The initial part to understand why there is a problem with ill will, why there is a problem with sensuality. And once you start to get your mind down the right track and understand these things, and you keep on reflecting on that, gradually your mind starts to move around and take a new direction. This is the problem with habits. Our habits are very strong and very ingrained. They're like hurtling down the railway track at 100, 200 kilometers an hour, whatever it is, really, really fast. And to change that railroad, that train, which is very heavy, to make it move in a different direction, because it's like a habit is the kind of force it moves forward with. That's the habit of the trainer. To make it move in a different direction, it takes time. Gradually move it around until eventually it's facing 100 degrees in the opposite direction. It's coming back again. And this is what we're doing with our mind. This is why you have to be gentle with yourself. You have to be careful with yourself. You have to give yourself time. You have to be very patient with yourself, because your mind is like that rail, train going really fast. Always conditioned in a certain way. Now you're going to recondition it. It is not done overnight. It takes time. So be patient. Take care. Keep on doing it again and again and again. And slowly, gradually, you will see the change. Over the weeks, over the months, over the years, the mind will actually turn around and head in a different direction. It works. And this is the marvelous thing about it. It actually works. This is not just in some kind of paper, ink on paper. This actually is reality. It actually functions this way. You can change your habits. It's difficult to change our habits, but it can be done. As long as you persevere, as long as you are fully committed to this, it's going to happen. Guaranteed. But you have to put in the effort. And here, the most important part of the effort is reflection, contemplation, wisdom power. That is the most important thing here. So come back to these things, reflect on them, read the sutta, think, what does this mean? How do I actually understand that these things are problematic? Why is ill will problematic? Why is sensual pleasures, why are they problematic? Focus on the ill will, that's the most important one. Don't worry too much about the sensual pleasures, because it's more difficult. And ill will is far more destructive. So start with the ill will. If down the track you wanted to do sensual pleasures as well, you can. But ill will should be the main focus for most people. And then the path after a while becomes quite easy. When these things become your new habits, and you start to think like this, the path down the track becomes easier and easier and easier. The initial thing is the hardest part. Then when it becomes a new habit of thinking, it happens automatically. Okay, so then we have the other side of the story here. As I abided thus, heedful, energetic, and with effort, a thought of renunciation arose in me. I understood thus, this thought of renunciation, of, you know, of giving up sensuality, really, has arisen in me. This does not lead to my own affliction or to the affliction of others or to the affliction of both. It aids wisdom, does not cause difficulties, and leads to nirvana. No problem. If I think and ponder upon this thought, even for a night, even for a day, even for a night and day, I see nothing to fear from it. But with excessive thinking and pondering, I might tire my body. And when the body is tired, the mind becomes strained. And when the mind is strained, it is far from samadhi, far from stillness. So I steadied my mind internally, quieted it, brought it to singleness, and stilled it. Why is that? So that my mind should not be strained. So you have moved your mind around. You are thinking differently. Your thought is kind of coming in line with the Dhamma. You start to understand the world according to how the Buddha understands the world. And there's nothing to fear from those thoughts, except for one thing, and that is, if you think too much, it tires you out. The mind, the body becomes tired. Here, the body is probably a word for your mental world as a whole, including all aspects of the mental world, whereas the mind is probably more your ability, your consciousness, or more the awareness aspect of the mind. Something like that is what is going on here now. So if you think and ponder too much, thinking and pondering is tiring in its own right. And that's why you want to still the mind at that particular point. This shows you an important principle again in Buddhism, the idea of the gradual training. You don't start off by stilling the mind straight away. You start off by abandoning the defilements, first of all. And once those negative thoughts, those defiled thoughts are out of the way, then you still the mind. This is kind of important, because very often people kind of walk off the street into a meditation center, and they all sit down and watch the breath. Well, nobody asks them whether they have defilements in the mind or not. Nobody asks them whether they are ready for that. They just say, watch the breath. Okay, watch the breath. And it becomes really silly, because you can't watch the breath. It's impossible. Well, you can, but you have to use a lot of force. So it's kind of using the Buddha's teachings in an unskillful way when these things happen. It's very important to get these things in the right way. Start off with virtue, with kindness. Learn how to deal with your thinking mind in the right way. Then, finally, when you have the right kind of thinking in your mind, and this is why I make such emphasis on the idea of having the right attitude, because the right attitude is nothing but right thinking, the right kind of thinking you have here. And then when the attitude is right, the thinking is right, the mindfulness comes, then meditation becomes possible. There is a sequence here. That sequence is so important. Get the sequence wrong, it's not going to work. That's basically the reality of it. And here it becomes very clear what that sequence is. And then when the thinking is right, that is when the meditation starts, and you still the mind. This is what is happening here. And then, of course, as you do that, you steady your mind eternally, quiet it, bring it to singleness, and still it. And all of this is really a sign of samadhi, sign of jhanas. And these are words that are used to describe jhanas and deep samadhi in the suttas. There you are. It's interesting here the word vitakka is used. The word vitakka is used for the thinking mind. And then later on, after you steal everything down, vitakka is also used for the first jhana afterwards. And it shows you that vitakka has two different meanings. It does not mean that after you steal the mind, obviously, it must have a different meaning from before you steal the mind, where you are thinking. And this is one of those great suttas that shows you how vitakka
the thought actually changes its meaning as you practice the path. So then, the same thing for the other positive thoughts. As I abided thus, heedful, energetic, and with effort, a thought of non-ill will arose in me, a thought of non-harming arose in me, a thought of compassion, in other words. I understood thus, this thought of non-harming has arisen in me. This does not lead to my own affliction, or to the affliction of others, or to the affliction of both. It aids wisdom, does not cause difficulties, and leads to extinguishment. If I think and ponder upon this thought, even for a night, even for a day, even for a night and day, I see nothing to fear from it. But with excessive thinking and pondering, I might tire my body. And when the body is tired, the mind becomes strained. And when the mind is strained, it is far from stillness. So I steadied my mind internally, quieted it, brought it to singleness, and stilled it. Why is that? So that my mind should not be strained. Then we have the simile again. Just as in the last month of the hot season, when all the crops have been brought inside the villages, a cowherd would guard his cows while staying at the root of a tree or out in the open, since he needs only to be mindful that the cows are there. So too, there was need for me only to be mindful that those qualities were present. So now the cowherd can kind of relax. Yeah, he sits down at the root of a tree, leans back, maybe enjoys a bit of meditation. Maybe not. But anyway, there's no problem with the cows going anywhere because the crops have been taken away, the defilements have been removed, yeah? There's nothing interesting there anymore. So because of that, you can actually start to relax. And this is another aspect of the path. The path is always more difficult in the beginning. Yeah? The more purified you are, the more easy it tends to become because these things become natural aspects of who you are. They become part of your psychology. Yeah, you actually become a more kind person. You become more pure. Yeah, this is how you change in this way. So actually, the whole path happens more automatically as a consequence. Of course, you can't risk not watching out. You still have to be mindful. This is what it says here: mindful that the cows are there. So you're mindful that those qualities remain. And if you have a kind of a recurrence of bad qualities, of course, you have to deal with that. But it becomes easier as you move down the track. And this is what this last paragraph is about. Because whatever a bhikkhu frequently thinks and ponders upon, that will become the inclination of his mind. Yes, you frequently think and ponder upon kindness, metta, karuna. After a while, you become that karuna and metta. That is where your mind inclines. Yeah? If he frequently thinks and ponders upon thoughts of renunciation, he has abandoned the thought of sensual desire to cultivate the thought of renunciation. And then his mind inclines to thoughts of renunciation. If you frequently think and ponder upon thoughts of non-ill will, of metta, if you like, of non-cruelty, of compassion, he has abandoned the thought of harming to cultivate the thought of compassion. And then his mind inclines to thoughts of compassion. Yeah, so this is kind of the ideal, when the mind inclines in those directions. Of course, that makes it much easier. So, what happens then? And that's really the main part of that sutta. This is why I brought this up, just to show you how the ideal way of dealing with the problems of the mind. And once that is done, at the very last there, the Buddha says, tireless energy was aroused in me. Tireless, because the defilements have been abandoned. When there are no defilements, the energy becomes tireless. Unremitting mindfulness was established. This means the mindfulness it doesn't kind of change, it doesn't kind of get weak. Yeah, it is there all the time. My body was tranquil and untroubled, and my mind was stilled and unified as a consequence of abandoning all these defilements. So there you are. That is kind of just setting out the main ideas of how to remove defilements of the mind. This afternoon I'm going to have a look at an even more specific case on that, which is specifically about how to remove resentment and anger and ill will. And I'm going to go into even more detail how to deal with this. That is because this is the worst of all the defilements, is anger and ill will. It is the one that is easiest to deal with and causes the most suffering. And for this reason, it is, I think, extraordinarily useful to know how to deal with this so we can actually overcome this. So that is what's going to happen this afternoon. And in the meantime, at 10:15, if those who wish to come for a session of interviews and talk a little bit, you're welcome to come. That will again be behind the reception area in the room all the way down.